to it, please help me welcome the director of RoboCop, José Padilha.
É Brasil!
Round of applause for the lovely and talented Abbie Cornish. We're going to have a little time at the end to take your questions for this illustrious panel, so think about what you might want to ask. José, I'll start with you. RoboCop is a beloved film. What made you want to reimagine it in a modern-day setting?
The fact that it's a beloved film. Listen, RoboCop is a brilliant film. I saw it in 87. I was way younger. It's just a film you cannot do again. I mean, we didn't try to redo the same RoboCop because it was perfect the way it was. We just took the concept of RoboCop, and there are a lot of bright ideas in that movie, and we brought it to the present. And we are more and more in a society that RoboCop is relevant. We now actually see drones being used in wars, and we will soon be seeing robots being used in war, as you've seen in the footage. This is going to become a big issue. That's why we tackle this.
Yeah, humanity and human rights versus machine is much more relevant now than when the first film was made. It's perfect.
Yes, and the first film saw it, which is a great merit. They saw that way back. Now we have more knowledge of how this is going to go down, and I think it's going to go down exactly as you see. First, we're going to be using machines abroad in foreign policies and interventions, and then we're going to bring machines home.
And Michael, Raymond Sellers strikes me as a guy who believes 100% that he's right.
Yeah, I mean, I think he sees even more, actually. I think he sees that maybe, you know, how you define what is right and what is wrong. You know, he's a complex dude. He's a big thinker. But if you had to put, you know, he had to check a box, right or wrong, he'd say, no, what I'm doing is basically right. He understands the bigger question and the moral issue of that, but he sees the bigger picture and he simplifies everything. He's the ultimate pragmatist, and he says, this is your choice. This is the world we live in. Am I wrong because I think if I do this, that, you know, the world will be a better place? And if the answer is no, you're not wrong, he says, well, then that's what we need to do, you know. This is the issue at hand.
And Sam, Pat Novak, that's a show that could be on television right now. Completely believable. Did you find any inspiration in any of these broadcasters, maybe, to get the feel for Pat Novak's vibe?
Well, I like to refer to Pat Novak as Rush Sharpton. So we kind of get a combination of those two guys. A guy who has an opinion, who's not afraid to state it, and uses every means necessary to get people to agree with him.
Joel, let's talk a little bit about the challenges as an actor of playing man and machine fused. Not a lot of roles like that out there. How did you work towards achieving that?
Well, a big difference from the original to our version is that Alex doesn't die. They managed to save his life, and he's amputated from throat down, pretty much. And he has some form of respiratory system inside the armor. And over the course of the movie, he has this internal battle with the artificial intelligence and his own soul or his own humanity, and that was the challenge to portray that, and that's what I think we were able to do.
And Abbie, I think this film, more than people would expect, is also a tremendous love story and about a relationship. You want to talk a little bit about your character?
Yeah, I think what's nice about the Murphy family is it sort of grounds the film in basic humanity. The idea of love, of marriage, of having a child. And so, particularly in the story of Robocop, because he does become half man, half robot, it's how he is affected on a deeper level in regards to his wife, his child, and the emotions, and how that interacts with the robot part of his, of who he has become as well. So it was a really lovely role to play, you know, playing the loving, grounded, very wholesome, and it was kind of nice to play a woman who really fought for her man.
José, did you bring any footage to show these people in RoboCop?
Yeah, we got some footage.
Would you guys like to see it? Man inside the machine.
Yeah.
Is that a pragmatic one, or does he really think it's going to make the product better if that steps in?
Well, I do it at home at the garage. So, give me the question again. Is it a pragmatic one, or what?
Is he just trying to sell the American people the product, or does he think the product will actually
be better? No. He's a believer. I mean, the thing about sellers is, money's fun, and there's a lot of it, and it's fun to make it, but he's way, way, way past that. This guy's a big, big thinker. You may not agree with him, but no, he's a believer. This is something he believes. But like I said, not to be too big a deal of it, but I think he thinks past that question of, you know, is this right or wrong? In fact, I always saw him as a guy who's deeply involved in this, and in that little other part of his brain, he's also thinking of the next move. You know, he's thinking, how do I spin this off into the next thing? You know, space, probably.
Joel, as an actor, when you're wearing a shield that obscures half your face, you find yourself having to use other tools to try to get your performance out there?
I'm not going to say what Michael just said. Well, in all the scenes where there's like social interaction, the visor comes up. So as soon as he's threatened, or when a crime is committed in his near vicinity, that's when the visor comes down. So in all the interactions, the actual scenes, the visor is up, except when I'm pissed, because then it comes down. So. I mean, yeah, there was some jaw action, you know. I had to like perfect my jaw, my jaw acting. I think I got a lot better at it. Getting close to the end of the movie, like I'd be angry with only my mouth.
Nailed the jaw.
Like that kind of thing.
All right, let's take some questions from the audience. I'm sure you guys have questions for this panel. Can we turn the light up on our microphone and get our first question up there? Hello, sir. What's your question?
Yeah, I have a question for the director. But Joel, real quick, Holder, Winden. Since Mulder and Scully, just great you guys.
Thanks, man.
I'm José, huge fan of the Elite Squad. Great visual style, big on socio-political commentary, and that was the same with the original RoboCop. Are you bringing that to this version?
Yeah, listen, our movie has, it's about something, you know, it's fun, it has a lot of action, as you've seen, but it's also a movie that talks about the near future. Right now we are already seeing drones being used in wars. Right, and if you think about it for a second, we will soon be seeing robots being used in wars, and this has any law enforcement, and this has a huge impact in society. When a policeman, for instance, makes a mistake and shoots a child, you can judge the policeman. You can say you can put him on trial. It makes sense. If a robot makes a mistake and shoots a child, you cannot judge a robot. Whose mistake is it? Is it the software manufacturer? Is it the city that put the robot down there? All of these issues are going to be more and more present, and the movie deals with them all throughout its plot, you know, so there is a social issue. And there's also a lot of fun and irony, like Pat Novak is a very ironic character that shows a little bit of the state of the media, biased media, and, you know, I think we kept a lot of the original.
Thank you. Hi, what's your question?
Hi. Yeah, I was just wondering, so in the original RoboCop, there was a scene when they're putting together Alex Murphy, and they have the option of keeping his arm, or just completely cutting it off. And I noticed in the trailer, he decided to keep his hand, and wondering if that was in relation to the original purpose of that?
No. Well, there is a premise in our movie, which is this. I'm going to spell it out anyway. So, our movie is in the future, and in the future, America and other countries are using drones and robots in foreign policy, right? But because a robot cannot be accountable, robots cannot pull the trigger domestically at home. So, OCB, Omnicorp, they are losing a lot of money because they cannot sell robots in America. So how do they circumvent the law? They put a man in the machine. They create a machine with a conscience. That's the idea. They have to sell the idea that this is a machine and that this is a man. And you know, man greets like this, right? You, this is how we greet me here. This is what you do. So they keep his hand for that reason only.
Human contact. That's great. Hi, what's your question?
Hi. Firstly, I just want to say you're well. It's nice to meet another sweet here at Comic-Con. Me and my brothers just flew in the other day, so...
I'm a kid to have.
No, I'm not kidding. So, my question is, what are the similarities to the older version of Comic-Con? And what will tempt the newer audience to come and see this one? What are its strengths?
The trailer you just saw. I mean, that's basically the only tool we usually have. We read the script, you don't. We go in and do the work and hope that you guys like it. The only way we'll find that out is after you see the trailer, you pay your money, you come in, you see it, you tweet your friends and say, wow, you gotta see this shit, or not. So that's pretty much what it is. That's why we're here, to juice you up so that you can tell your friends, look, I saw this thing, looks like it's going to be great, so hopefully let's go see it. And if the fruits of our labor turn out to be great, then we certainly appreciate it, because we did everything we could to entertain and inform you, and hopefully that's what we'll do when you see it.
My question is, how is Michael Keaton, by the way, Batman, awesome. My question is, how is the role that you play in this movie different from other roles that you played? This is mine? Everyone. I think it was for you, Mike.
I'm sorry.
Do you have a preference, heroes or villains, who to play in terms of when you consider a role?
No, I kind of don't think about anything until I see it, and then I think, oh yeah, that's... I'm up for one of these. And the thing about this one was, José and I... He's, I guess, technically, he's not a villain, he's kind of an antagonist. I don't really see him necessarily as a standard villain. But I'm sorry, I'm going to try to answer your question. This one was kind of complex, because I didn't want to do the, you know, cliched bad guy. Also, he wasn't written like that, and José didn't want him to be played like that. And I'd say this one is... different in that it's not... I don't think... I'm trying to think if I've ever played someone who's... you know, kind of, not executive, but probably, and he's certainly not white collar. I don't know what he is. I don't think, well, you know, Bruce Wayne was a big thinker, but underneath he was a vigilante, too. And he had, he was, you know, darker and a little more... I find this guy actually basically really healthy, mentally healthy, just, you know, whether you agree with him or not is another issue. But I don't really, just different in that I've never played a guy who was supposed to be a billionaire, except Bruce was close. In 1989, he was probably worth a few hundred mil.
I'm sorry, I hope that answers it.
We have time for one more question. All right, thank you. Mr. Jackson, you and robots, we're going to go see this movie. All right, so actually I am a cyborg here. You can see I'm wearing Google Glass. Was the purpose of the story to show that technology is something that should be feared, or just that the people are should be feared, whether or not technology is involved?
Right, technology is not a thing that exists of itself, right? Technology is always made and used by people, deployed by people. So at the end of the day, you know, you should never fear a gun. You should fear the guy that's holding the gun, because the gun doesn't shoot itself. And it's the same thing with technology. Now, having said that, and looking at what human beings have done with guns, we should have very afraid about technology in the near future. And this movie talks a little bit about that, because it talks about what happens when you have a lot of imbalance between, you know, let's say a country that has drones and robots in war and a country that doesn't have it. How does a human being fight a robot? I mean, a robot can't die, human beings can. So the movie talks about that, I think, in a big way, and then also in a fun way, you know, in an ironic way, just like the first Robocop. We also have something that's going to happen, which is technology is going to meet living beings. We're going to have, you know, more and more we have interventions, like people can put chips in brains to recover vision, and we're going to have a mixture between man and machine. This is going to happen, right? And Robocop is just the perfect movie to address that, you know, and we try to do it.
Well, next year we all get to see it. 2014 Robocop will be hitting theaters.